Do you all know each other?
Some of us, yes.
I'm asking our members here. You all know each other? No.
They don't. Emily and
Daisy.
They are from China. They know each other.
Okay. Anybody here not familiar with Bhagavad Gita? Not familiar. Okay. We're going to be speaking about Bhagavad Gita a little bit. So I'm going to give you a little background of what it is, okay? Those of you that aren't familiar with Bhagavad Gita, are you familiar with yoga? He's familiar with yoga. Little boy in the back. One way to describe what Bhagavad Gita is it's an ancient text that describes not just the yoga that is taught in yoga classes, the asanas, sitting postures on a yoga mat, and then breathing exercise called pranayama. But there's multiple yoga systems, in short, and karma yoga, hatha yoga that is taught in yoga classes, dhyan yoga, sankhya yoga, bhakti yoga, gyan yoga, different yoga systems, and they all share some similar points. The main goal of all of them is elevation of consciousness. Because out of the evolution of the species of life up to the human form of life, unique in the human form of life is the capacity to know who we are, the spark of life within, different than the covering, this body. Just like you've got a blue sweatshirt on. But you're not Mr. Blue Sweatshirt. That's not who you are. You can take that one off and become green t-shirt tomorrow, and it doesn't change your identity because it's just a covering of the body. Similarly, the body is a covering of who we really are, the spark of life within. And the yoga system is to realize who we are and live your life according to who you really are and connect your consciousness to this, we'll call it the place of higher consciousness. And each of the yoga systems has that purpose. And so I'll be discussing from Bhagavad Gita different messages you'll see shortly. And I'm to get the remote device going. There's the picture of the Bhagavad Gita. It's from a very vast body of literature called Veda. In Sanskrit, Veda means knowledge. Like this is a university and many departments of knowledge, but all together as a university. So the many departments of knowledge within the Vedas, just like the knowledge of yoga. Or I'm sure somewhere at UT there's a school of medicine. So within the Vedas there's a division, a branch called Ayurveda. Any of you heard of that? Natural medicine? Just like in China, it's traditional Chinese medicine. So this is traditional Vedic medicine, Ayurveda. A division of knowledge in the Vedas on architecture, on cosmology, structure of the universe, and all different divisions of knowledge that's within the Vedas. And Bhagavad Gita specifically is speaking about the elevation of consciousness to realize who we are through the yoga system. So, and with it, a way of life, a yoga lifestyle. How, what to eat, how to work, etc. This process of meditation and yoga described in Bhagavad Gita, there are different ideas that people have out there who it's meant for, and some people think it's something you do when you get old. And then, because when you're young, you work hard and you develop your career and your family and everything. And then you do this when you're at a later stage of life. Some people think it's for children before they take exams. There's a young Indian student that told me that his mother taught him before you take your exams, make sure you do your meditation. And her explanation was, when you have an exam, you're going to, all the information and things that you've learned, you're going to have to provide it, produce it. And if you're if you've done your meditation, your mind will be more clear and more concentrated, and you'll do better in your exams. So make sure you do your meditation before your exams. So he's been doing that since childhood. And then he came across Bhagavad Gita. Some people think it's something that you really take seriously when your body starts to fall apart. Or something that people who are monks and renounced people or priests, that's what they do. The text of Bhagavad Gita, however, is the speaker is Krishna, and the person who is hearing the message is Arjuna, who's a warrior. And the whole description takes place on a battlefield just before a massive army of two sides are lined up. Arjuna wants to see who's on both sides, and he sees the array that's about to take place, and he decides, I can't go through with this. He gives his high-minded reasons why, and then submits to Krishna that I really don't know what my duty is. Kindly instruct me. So that's the context, and the practical spirituality that flows from that is found in the text of Bhagavad Gita. But Arjuna wasn't a monk. He's in the middle of many, many millions of warriors ready to fight, very powerful hero. He wasn't a renounced man, he was a householder with children and the family life. And he wasn't just a meek, holy person, he was a powerful, strong hero, a warrior. So he was an eligible candidate. He was especially eligible because of his high-mindedness. And we're not likely to be in the midst of a battle as a great warrior leading millions of people. But we all have the experience of the battlefield of the mind. Because the essential part of yoga and meditation is bringing the mind to a peaceful state and directing the mind towards this place of higher consciousness. And in our modern times, how to do that can be a little difficult because it's like gets complicated. Not so practical to sit in the middle of a board meeting and do your meditation and yoga. But practically speaking, how is this to be done? You have busy lives. You're students now, but as you get older, your roles and responsibilities will become more complex. Naturally so. And we sometimes find ourselves in the midst of very complicated situations. So how are we supposed to make this practical? That's the question. It's practical because it has to do with who we really are. And although situations may be, in modern times particularly, more and more complex, it's principle-based, it's very simple. We don't have to neglect our worldly duties or your personal nature, how you conduct yourself, at any age, any circumstance, any time, because the principles are universal principles. They apply equally to everybody, ancient times and modern times. It's easy because it's a joyful process. Something that's very joyful makes it easier to do. There's a text in Bhagavad Gita from Drishta in Sanskrit. One can experience a higher taste. It's just like if you're offered some options, would you like this or this or that? And amongst the options is something that you really enjoy. It's an easy selection. You take the something that you really enjoy. So when there's an inner contentment, the message of Bhagavad Gita teaches that real happiness is not by having objects, and the more objects and abundance makes for happiness. Wealth gives options, gives possessions and objects for you to have in your possession, and that's going to make you happy. That's the paradigm of modern life. However, it's not so. I didn't know this until just yesterday. No, this past weekend. We have a farm community in Pennsylvania, not far from Penn State, about 45 minutes from Penn State, right in the Amish country, mid-Pennsylvania. And there were about 140 students from 9 different universities taking part in a retreat. Mantra, meditation, retreat with cows. And it was a very nice experience. So one of the slides that was provided for me to speak about was from, I didn't know this till afterwards, apparently he's a celebrity, James Conway or something like that, a comedian. Does that mean anything to any of you? He said, apparently he's like a well-known, if I have the name right, well-known person. I really wish that all young people in America today could fulfill all of their dreams for wealth and possessions, because by having that, then they'll realize real happiness isn't found there. So many studies in economics to prosperity in the world, in China certainly, And in America certainly, and Europe certainly, prosperity has increased, but the report of happiness is not at all increasing, it's practically flat. This is just subjectively people reporting happiness. And the degree of depression in America today and in the world today, I was recently visiting in China, so it's fresh in my mind. 100 million people in China are reported as having clinically depressed condition. That's a lot of people. And 300 million in the world, so maybe one-third of the world's population. Same statistic in America. One-third of the population. One-third of the population. In America has clinical depression. Prosperity is greater. Happiness is flat. Depression is, it's an epidemic. There are many statistics indicating this. So, meditation and yoga of Bhagavad Gita helps us connect with a happiness that's within. Because that's where real happiness is. It's not in having things from outside, bringing the senses in contact with objects and then that's happiness. That's the paradigm of ordinary life. Bhagavad Gita teaches differently. That greater happiness, this higher taste, is within. And this is my practical experience as a college student and even until today. That is, when I began yoga and meditation, the form of yoga that I practice is bhakti yoga. It's found in Bhagavad Gita, so it's different than the asanas and all of that. But from practicing bhakti yoga, mantra meditation and bhakti yoga, I found, although it took me, I spent 2 hours minimum every morning doing mantra meditation and other bhakti yoga practices added to that. But it gave me so much energy that my sleep naturally reduced without any other effort to do so by 2 hours. So the time it took me to do the 2 hours of mantra meditation was taken over by, my body was more energized. I was more energized. And then when I did my academic work, because I was far more concentrated, it took much less time. It gave me about an extra half an hour less of academic work. So I had some time for reading Bhagavad Gita. I found, you know, lighter, concentrated, energized, very practical benefits that come. Here's another image from Bhagavad Gita. This is the speaker, Krishna. He's the chariot driver of this warrior Arjuna picture here. And in the scene is the battlefield. So the principle of Bhagavad Gita is found in this 8th chapter. Mam anusmara yujyacha. Anusmara means to remember. So remember Krishna and engage in prescribed duties. Two things, what your mind does and what your body does. Mind, through meditation, goes to Krishna, just like the Hare Krishna mantra you were singing when I came in. When the attention of the mind, instead of to temporary things, goes to Krishna, then that meditation, and then with your body, the practical duties of life, we all have good to do them most likely anyways, then you have made the basic foundation of the yoga process. Yoga process is very simple, pictured here. It's just offering with love and devotion a leaf, a flower, fruit, or water. The process is so simple even a child can do, so we can do it. And the things that you do every day, you eat something every day, so you take that something that you eat and you make an offering to Krishna. And through this musical, just like we were doing a little while ago, this musical performance of singing can be done in by those in the renounced order, by those in family life. It can be done in any position, in the city, in the country, at any age. So when is it appropriate to become knowledgeable and live a lifestyle of yoga like this? This is a message from another text from the Vedas, this vast body of literature, spoken by this little boy. His name is Prahlad. And in his school, he was teaching his friends that from the tender age of 5 years old, as a youth, one can learn and understand and practice and live this lifestyle of yoga. And that's the real benefit of knowledge, is knowing who you are. Say it negatively. If you learn so many, 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 many things, and you become a professor of so many, many things, but you don't know who you are, you haven't really developed knowledge. A little sharing, because it often gets asked at the end anyways, how did you get started in this? That's a common question. And so how I got started was when I was in college, it was some years ago, the United States was involved in the Vietnamese War. So I was in pre-med studies and accepted to med school. And my parents were telling me at home, they were getting these draft notices from the Army, 1A classification, meaning you're drafted, come to the Army office, get an Army uniform, we're going to put you on a plane and send you to Vietnam. And I thought, that's really dumb. Why would they take, the war itself is dumb, and take somebody out of medical school and send them off to that dumb war is double dumb. So, you know, I just ignored it. And they kept getting notices, and they started getting on my case, you gotta do something. They'll put you in jail. You gotta do something. And so I shrugged my shoulders and said, I guess I gotta do something. And the advice I was given was, those of you from America, you know who the Quakers are. Yes? Nice group of people. A Christian organization. And they had a little facility to teach people, prepare people, how to file a conscientious objector form. At the time, it was called CO, conscientious objector. This is government form, so I got one. And the first question is, state the nature of your belief such that you cannot take part in the armed forces of America. State the nature of your convictions such that you cannot take part in the armed forces of the United States of America. So, A student, dean's list, you know, I know how to get A's in exams, you know what the people want, you give the answer. But the pen wouldn't move because I was unable to express to my own satisfaction what my convictions were. And a little light went on saying, what? I'm on this conveyor belt of success in life, all the things, da-da-da-da-da-da, but I don't know what my convictions are. And something's wrong with that. And then with that question that I didn't have an answer to came 99 other questions I didn't have answers to. They're very fundamental questions, but I was too busy being successful to ask fundamental questions. I became very disturbed. I felt I'd been cheated or something. So I was determined, I'm going to get an answer to these questions. Not answers that get me the A in the exam or get freed from, you know, the draft notice, but so that at the end of the conveyor belt of life, I'm still not in this blank space where I don't know what my convictions are, or I don't know who I am, really. I don't want to do that. So my advice to you, if you forget everything else, don't forget this one. Don't be in that position. It takes some time to introspect, and part of the introspection process is to have a mind that's free. And that's the meaning of mantra. Man refers to the mind, and tra means to free the mind. It's like I'm holding onto this little device that changes slides. So if I wanted some water, here's some over here, I have to let go of this thing so I can take the water bottle and take some water. So same, if you want to know who you are, the mind is presently carrying conceptions that have nothing to do with who we are. I'm a UT student, my major is such and such, I'm from this country, this culture, this language, this race, this background, da-da-da-da-da-da. And that's who I am. That's not who we are. That's the blue shirt instead of the green t-shirt. It's the covering, but it's not who we really are. There's Bhagavad Gita teaches from the very, very beginning. I was just listening today to Newsday magazine interviewing our founder, the translator of this Bhagavad Gita, the founder, my spiritual master and teacher, Guru, asking him questions, probing, kind of soft but challenging questions. And he really drilled them to understand if you don't know who you are, whatever it is that you're doing is a polished form of ignorance. Said it very, very, very bluntly. I could repeat some of those messages. But the value in modern education and modern society has to do with the covering, the body and the mind. But what's really valuable or important is the spark of life within, the seat of consciousness within, because that's who we really are. He was giving the example of a car. You need to put gas in the car, but you need to give food to the driver. If you give gas to the driver, that won't sustain his life. If you give food to the car, that isn't going to run the car. You have to take care of the driver. That's like, you know, who we are. And then the body is the machine. Literally, the language of Bhagavad Gita speaks like that. Yantra Rudhani Maya. Yantra means machine. So the body is a machine. And when the spark of life leaves the body, what's the value? The value is the spark of life inside, and it animates and expands consciousness through the body and out into the world. So the valuable thing is who you really are. Where's the knowledge of teaching us who we really are? So doesn't take the United States government telling you you're going to be a, you're going to go off to Vietnam, or unless you start to learn who you really are. That's one way. That's what happened with me. At least, you know, that was my response. But Bhagavad Gita gives education who you really are. And when, is, that was the question being asked in the slide, is when is it appropriate? Early and on in life, as far as possible, like this young boy. How old are you?
Gopal.
How old are you?
Six.
So, because his mother and father, I'm sure they're giving him the other education as well, but starting from childhood, he's learning who are you really? Gopal.
Who are you?
So, Gopal. Gopal, point to your head. Point to your foot. Point to your arm. Point to your chest. Now point to you. That's your crew. Where's you? Sometimes children go like this. That's the end. But who we are, so are this. We are a soul with a spark of life inside. That's who we really are. So things that pertain to the body, whatever your department of study is, engineering, IT is very popular these days, whatever it is, something that has to do with the body or the mind, it's incomplete without knowing who you are. Put gas in the car, but without the driver, the car doesn't go anywhere. Both are valuable. We take care of the body, but that's not all. And advancement of civilization isn't just doing the same things in a more polished way. We eat and the animals eat. We reproduce and animals reproduce. We defend and animals defend. We do it in a more sophisticated way. That's not advancement of civilization. The advancement of civilization is to know who you are. Animals, you can't have a discussion with an animal. Who are you really? That they don't have the capacity. Consciousness is not a powerful condition. But when the human form of life comes, when it's appropriate, it's even best from the early age. It's never too early, and it's never too late. But it's important. In fact, it's urgent because time, as time ticks, the conveyor belt is moving us along, and we're getting closer and closer to still not knowing. That's not a good position to be in. So in my case, I did a timeout. It doesn't require a timeout. It's something you can cultivate side by side with whatever you're doing. But don't delay. It's a priority. Now, how to approach the process, how to begin. I use this image because sometimes that consciousness is compared to like a little seed that stays dormant and dormant and dormant and dormant until you decide you want to germinate the seed. So then you apply some water and some sunlight, and the life inside the seed starts to awaken. It's dormant. It can stay for hundreds of years. Hard shell inside a nicely protected packaging, nature's packaging. But life is inside. And then life sprouts by the sprouting process. So this yoga lifestyle process awakens this dormant consciousness. How does it begin? There's an idea that's expressed in Bhagavad Gita. It is Arjuna hearing from Krishna. There's lines coming from Krishna into this world. And there's four principal ones. Here's a chart showing them. I'm not going to go into it because it's a little confusing. But the line that I am connected with is Krishna imparted this knowledge first to Brahma, pictured here. Brahma, in turn, imparted this knowledge to Narada. Narada imparted this knowledge to his student, Vyas. And it goes on through the ages. Vyas imparted this knowledge to Madhva. And then a line from Madhva leading to Chaitanya. This is 530 something years ago. And he in turn instructed to a group called the Goswamis in Vrindavan. Rupa Goswami amongst them taught to Jiva Goswami and Raghunath Das Goswami. These names don't mean anything to you, but it's just showing by images. There's a line of disciplic succession going, spanning over a long period of time. Narottam Das Thakur, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, Jagannath Das Babaji. These are names that don't mean anything to you. But just like take this, this is Bhaktivinoda. He lived in the late 1800s and very early part of 1900s. He was a householder. He had 10 children. He was a high court judge during the height of the British rule, which was an unheard of thing for an Indian to be in such a highly respected position, a magistrate. Like next to being the governor of the state. Very highly placed person. But he was a great leader. He wrote 100 books, along with these 10 children, performing his worldly duties. His in line, Gorky Shore, Bhakti Siddhanta, and this is my spiritual master who translated the Bhagavad Gita that I'm giving my life to and sharing with you, and some of his students. For this is an image in Golden Gate Park in San Francisco when they had a big festival and everyone was taking part. So there's this line pictured here saying some of the images I'm showed you before. It's mentioned in Bhagavad Gita that just like here at the university. Well, I was studying medicine. So I could have just studied medical books. But I don't think there'd be too many people that said, oh, you study medical books, I need some surgery, can you do an operation on it? Not so likely. Probably being subject to breaking the law. So I was going to university to study from professors of those fields of medicine. Or you can get a book on yoga and learn to do asanas, you don't go to yoga class. But we learn from a teacher because that's the system mentioned in Bhagavad Gita. So we needed someone who's actually a qualified representative of a line of teachers from the original teaching. And our condition may be less than perfect, but by following one who has that qualification, one can then transmit knowledge in the proper way. That's a qualification. Have studied the texts, understood the essence, live their life accordingly, actually, by their own lifestyle. They don't just teach one thing and do another thing. They teach by their own example. They have control of their mind and senses. These are qualifications of a teacher. There's a text from, again, from Bhagavad Gita. Try to learn the truth by approaching the spiritual master. Inquire from him submissively and render service unto him. The self-realized souls can impart knowledge. Because they have seen the truth. This is the process of getting this practical spirituality in our lives. So the last is just a graphic saying the same thing. Over here on the left, this is our life where happiness is bringing the senses in contact with objects. But when we have the opportunity getting some guidance of how to go to a place of higher consciousness, then self-realization is the result. We can know who we really are. There's another illustration showing the same thing. Like when children play on in a playground, seesaw. Now that we also call it teeter-totter. You heard that one before? So it requires a fulcrum and a board. So one child is over here, the other child is over there, and the child that's over here pushes up, and this one goes down, and then it goes down and pushes up, and the other one goes up. So here's where we are down here. We have material well-being, and we want spiritual well-being. So when spiritual instruction goes down, then our material well and spiritual well-being goes up. So here's the last image showing the same thing. In any yoga process, the function of the mind is very important. So we're over here in this covered condition. But when the mind becomes fixed by yoga practice and yoga discipline, and there's some instruction from a teacher, we get nice teaching, then our consciousness becomes elevated. That's the graphic way of saying what I've been describing. When that consciousness becomes elevated, then natural spiritual qualities become manifest also. Good character. Real education is character development. Real education is not just information. Say it the other way. Information without character development isn't really real good education. It can actually be dangerous. Technology or something, anything powerful in the hands of a fool can be very dangerous. So, last slide. There's to how to begin this practical spirituality. It starts with some mantra meditation, the image over here. As you were doing musical meditation, so also using meditation beads. Do you have something to look at that? Me too. I wish I was doing when I was six. You got a head start. Mantra meditation, reading of this wisdom literature, and again at any stage, any age. A diet that's vegetarian preferably, but natural, wholesome, mode of goodness foods, ideally foods that are then offered to Krishna. And joyfully singing and dancing. These are the four principal pillars of beginning spiritual, practical spirituality. So, if you, do we have copies of Bhagavad Gita for people that don't have?
We have
a few copies.
Okay. We have some copies of Bhagavad Gita. If you don't have it, if you'd like, we'll make the copy available for you.
go follow the hand of others. Who would like a copy that doesn't have a copy? Go follow. You're gonna need one more, you're gonna need two. Yep, two more. There's one on the desk that I was holding here. Go follow, here you go. Here, one more. Whoop. That's yours? Okay. Who would like a copy? Hey, go follow, way over there. Way over there.
Those who have given, those who have taken books can give you their ID. And I'm passing the cell phones.
Okay. So, that's just a simple introduction to see if there's some discussion. I tried to go quickly because I've learned students have busy lives and attention span is always thinking what the next thing they have to do is. So I tried to go quickly. It's very easy to take any one of these points and expand and discuss more forward. So any of the points we touched on, if you'd like some further explanation of or some comments or questions? Yes.
I have a question. It's not particular to any of the points discussed, but when you're beginning this journey of learning about yourself, how do you respond or make sure you're undisturbed to the noise that you may find in the material world, like engaging with others who you have for so long have engaged with, how to remain undisturbed by, you could say, noise?
Well, that's... And in a positive sense, the best thing is to have association with persons who, in a similar fashion, want to know who they really are. Association is absolutely important. It's a message of Bhagavad Gita. You develop qualities like those with whom you associate. Gopal, you go to school? In school, you know some kids that have bad behavior, they talk mean. So, first grade. Fifth? You're only 6 years old.
Yeah.
You're going to fifth grade already?
No. Maybe you meet them, that's what I'm surprised.
Okay, so those with whom you associate, you develop qualities like those with whom you associate. So if you're wanting to go on the path of self-realization, good to have association, practically essential to have association of others who are like-minded. Now that wasn't your question. Your question was, what about people that you've been growing up with or living with or have some relationship with, and they're not really so much interested. So how to address with that noise and that companionship. Continue friendship, but when it comes to the inner important things in your life, then the path of self-realization. You share that in a confidential way with people who are similarly minded. And what happens commonly is your circle of friends starts to change a little bit. The circle of friends of people who like a lifestyle, let's say a yoga lifestyle. They like vegetarian food instead of the other kind. They like hearing music and other sound vibrations that are consciousness elevating instead of the other kind. The circle of friends starts to change because of elevation of consciousness. It works the other way around too. Like supposing someone goes to a bar, or eventually they'll become habituated to that lifestyle, become, you know, addicted to or habituated to drinking. Just an anecdotal thing. 2 days ago, I had a conversation with an American gentleman who's a lawyer, and he's asking me, how's it going? So I told him what I had just done. I just spent this weekend at our farm community in Pennsylvania with 140 students in a monk meditation workshop weekend. And it was really nice. We learned a lot together, shared a lot together. And then, so he said, this is like a middle-aged man. He said, let me share this with you. You know, I've had an alcohol problem. So it was advised, why don't you try meditation? It might help you. And he's a member of the Unitarian Church. He knows I'm a Krishna devotee, we already have a relationship. So he said, it was amazing. In half an hour, I'm just like a beginner, in a half an hour of meditation, the anxiety and guilt that I've been carrying for quite some time, just having this alcohol thing in my life, it just went away. The anxiety and guilt went away. And, you know, in this hankering, because it's just become a habit, the alcohol habit, it lifted. I said, keep up the meditation. I said, I plan to. I said, that you've been doing this for over 40 years. So, you know, your inside must be clean. It must feel good. It's practical benefit. So, you're back to your question. The association is different than that. It just doesn't wish to have elevated approach to self-realization. The intimacy of that and the frequency of that association is likely to subside in favor of associations moving in this other direction, higher consciousness direction. Yeah.
Also wondering, so you were going to test this, that one of the paths to kind of freeing yourself of this material world is leaving material desires behind. And I was wondering, you know, when you think about when we do anything, Newton's law is covered how objects get, right? So if there's an external force, an object will accelerate.
Yeah.
And in the same way, if you kind of model human beings, an external force is like a desire that gets us to do something. And the perceived gain and happiness is what arising forces.
Yeah,
back.
Of course.
So
yeah,
if I were to let go of all my desires,
what would I do? It's a misconception.
Excuse me.
But the goal is not to become desireless, but to transfer desire towards a spiritual goal.
So, spiritualize your desire. Leave behind the material desire, but not, if you leave behind the desire, you have anesthetized yourself. But when the anesthesia wears off, here comes the desire again. So, the problem is not, if you're a Buddhist, the root cause of suffering is desire. To become free from suffering, become free from desire. How do you do that? Two things. Live a life in goodness, that's Bhagavad Gita language. The Eightfold Path of Gotama. Goodness, goodness, goodness. Live a life of goodness, that's the outside. And then inside, practice mindfulness. You know the term. And so be in the moment. And be in the moment. Not dwell in the past. Not obsess over the future. Because all there is the moment and the moment and the moment. And when you become very expert in being in the moment, go on the other side of the moment. What's over there? Nirvana. But nirvana, it's a Sanskrit term. Means cessation of material existence. Cessation of material activities. What do you do?
Nothing.
Who are you?
Nothing.
Less desire, less, less. No suffering. Yoga system, Bhagavad Gita doesn't say stop, that the root of all suffering is ignorance. Listen carefully. From ignorance comes ignorant desire. From ignorant desire comes ignorant activity. From ignorant activity comes suffering. The root cause of suffering is ignorance. And the primordial ignorance, the mama from which all of the little baby ignorances come, is ignoring who we really are. And therefore we accept some other identity of who we aren't. We have desires in the realm of who we aren't. That's material desire. So the premise of your statement, I listen carefully. Bhagavad Gita does speak about letting go, leaving behind material desire, but not desire. You have to have goals. You're alive. We have our spiritual life. We have desire. We want happiness. And to achieve happiness, it's not by living the life of who you are. And then trying different if the blue shirt didn't work, then we tried a green shirt. If that one didn't work, then we tried a suit. If that one didn't work, then we tried something else. It's not, and we're always changing bodies, but that's not who we are anyway. There's a verse in Bhagavad Gita, chapter 2, Krishna says, it's like changing bodies, it's like changing garments. When you change garments, you didn't change who you are. You change bodies, you don't change who you are. You're not the body. Then who are you? So, there is desire from the soul. Make desire spiritual. That's the art. Desire is the problem. Ignorance is the problem. Remove ignorance and what's left? Well, we really are still with that. So we have spiritual desire. Have abundant desire that moves towards the goal of knowing who you really are and connecting with that place of higher consciousness, connecting with Krishna. That's yoga. Thinking. Yoga means thinking. But connect with that higher consciousness place.
So if you have only spiritual desire, would you
still go to college?
Would you still like want to do that in school?
Yeah, absolutely. But the motivation of why you go to school is not just so I can get a degree, so I can get a good job, so I can get some money, and I can be an enjoyer stuff. And I can be proud of myself, I did it, yay. that the real happiness is in the zero.
So the motivation would be something else?
Yes, of course. Be very successful for a higher consciousness purpose. Now, that's a paradigm shift, and that's not easy to do. But that's the message of Bhagavad Gita. You, anyone, any one of us would be more successful if our motivation is that than if our motivation is down here. Because down here there's all kinds of duality. Sadness, disappointment, competition, anger, lust, greed, lower energy consciousness. And the higher energy consciousness doesn't mean you're lazy. Doesn't mean you don't have motivation. You don't have fuel in your tank, the rocket fuel. And you're excelling because you're in this higher consciousness space. There's much more clarity, everything.
So would you, if your motivation for it, if something is different, would you still feel unhappy when it's not achieved, or?
You're detached because the connection with the place of higher consciousness is your goal, not just achieving something that's temporary.
So you see it as a sub-goal
here. That achieving something temporary is not your goal. Let's just say, imagine I have pure consciousness. Imagine I have pure consciousness. Imagine yourself having pure consciousness. So, and you want to achieve something. You want to become, I don't know, whatever you want to become. Suppose something that's important to you in higher consciousness is, I know I should do some exercise regularly. I don't have to be the best exerciser, the guy that's first in the marathon, but I want to exercise because good health is necessary. If you have competition against somebody else, you're using the machine, the body, that's going to carry you to the place of higher consciousness. And so someday, there may be a stretch of time that you're like distracted because it's exam time or something. And you don't do it, so you don't feel as energized. But when you get, then you soon get back to your routine of doing exercise. So the goal is higher consciousness. It's not just, I want to feel body and I want to feel good. It's higher consciousness. So that's the motivation. Even if the circumstance changes, that same motivation of purpose, higher consciousness purpose is there. And anything else that you, a negative thing you want to get rid of or a positive thing you want to do, if the why is very strong and sustainable, it's spiritual, you're energized. So you're not disappointed about the result because you just keep, you're energized.
Right.
You keep looking in it because it's on a spiritual principle or principle of truth, it will grow. It may not be at a rate that you were hoping it would grow, but you're not attached to the rate, you're attached to the process of growth.
Yeah.
You know, you plant a garden, and some plants grow faster, some grow slower. But the garden principle is you keep watering, and this one's going to grow faster, it's going to grow slower, that's okay. You're next.
Yeah. So I want to ask. Some of the common experiences that I had as an identified Hindu is that there's often conflict between let's say, my beliefs, and how, especially when you're in a Western society, right? In Western society, people are not often exposed to the Bhagavad Gita, the Vedas, etc. So these things are undermined, disrespected through racism and, you know, certain challenges. Now, as a person who's trying to be as a Brahmana, you have to protect the tradition. And the reason why we're able to talk about these things is because there are people who protected this. And so, how does one find a balance between assertiveness and being in this state of mind? Because I find that when I'm in this state of mind, I don't want to be assertive at all. I let go of things and I'm peaceful. But one has to be assertive. Otherwise, the Bhagavad Gita and the Vedas will be trampled over.
No, you don't have to be assertive. You have to be genuine.
Okay.
I mean, I'm thinking, in response to your question, Mother Teresa, everybody knows Mother Teresa, someone shared this with me some time ago, a sign that she posted in one of her orphanage walls that said, you know, when you try to give good, to do good, some people will say you have a selfish motivation, do good anyways, you know. And then a whole series of these things. There's something that you create that's very wonderful can be destroyed in a day after you're gone. There's something wonderful in it. It's just, you know, live by principle. And if people just, you know, be, you know, this Mahatma thing. Be that example that you wish the world to be. Just be that. That you have to, like, get in an argument, just disputes, and, you know, stand up and just, you know, be that. Be the character. Exhibit the character that Bhagavad Gita teaches. Be a perambulatory Bhagavad Gita. That's what you should do. And truth will prevail. Light is stronger than darkness. You have confidence in that. Light is stronger than darkness. So be light. So just be a light in this world. That's what you should do. You don't have to argue with people or assert it or something.
Because in the moment in which you, sorry to interrupt, in the moment where you do not assert it, then it becomes trampled over. Or just, for example,
No. I've been doing this, you know, for a few years. And I'm not trampled over. Well, not a piece of grass that got stepped on, got squished on the side of the road. And it's not just in America. When you go to China, you don't go dressed like this because of the Chinese government. But go to China, it's a problem. And the Chinese government officers know I'm doing it. But, you know, I'm not getting trampled on. So, you're in America. Just, you know, be of that light. And you don't have to, you know, carry it like that with you. Hit people. They, you know, they're disrespectful. You may not stay in that place and keep close association with such a person. You don't have to do battle over ideology. It's more so, your achar is stronger than your prachar. Your character is stronger than the words you speak.
Right. The reason why I'm asking is because I'm in an academic environment, right? So I'm studying religious studies. I'm doing graduate school religious studies. So this is a predominantly Abrahamic dominated field. And so they undermine the stuff that you said.
That's okay. Be the example. Be Gandhi. Be the example of virtue. It's stronger. I'll give an example, and then we're going to call him both. Here at the UT campus, this is going back a number of years, I had a 6-foot table with some exhibits showing changing bodies and some books.
And I saw somebody coming from across the street, and he looked like he had steam coming out of his ears. He was a bit of a madman. And he came in front of me and leaned across the table and started shouting and screaming, you know, Christian stuff at me. And I just stood there. And he went on and on and on, and I just stood there because, you know. And four people came and tapped him on the shoulder and said, this isn't Christ-like. You know, they took him off and placed him. And so they began an argument with him because he's just an arguing type. To me, it was a message from Krishna. Had other things like that happen, that's just at this campus, right in front of the student union, that people were coming and going to get the mail. But I found a really good spot. It was on the sidewalk, the new spot. Nice. Big tree, with some shade. But I was being blessed. You know, spit was coming out of his mouth. It was so, like, hostile. I would like to spin out of it as Dennis's consciousness. And his own people checked him, took him to the side. This isn't Christ like behavior. Live the character of what Bhagavad Gita teaches. There's none better ism. So academics. This, you know, half shut knives. I'm aware. The fellow in the street is not far less sophisticated than the people in your department. But just, you know, the principles that you know are proof. Let's hear from both. I'm ready. Are you?
Who named the planet Earth?
Who named the planet Earth?
I don't know.
You got your...
Do you? Well, maybe you have to do some little research to find out. Yeah, well, you're a smart kid. You'll figure out how to do the research and find out your name. Yeah.
I want to ask a question. It's actually somewhat related to what was asked before. But, you know, we have all these spiritual ambitions that you talked about.
Yeah, good.
But we're also living in the world.
Yes, yes, we are.
And I, for one, have the things that I like and things that I dislike.
Yeah, sure.
And I sometimes feel that things should be different, or maybe I can feel like I'm being treated unfairly, and I can get resentful about that.
Sure.
And
that's a natural human.
I often feel that if I'm getting resentful about something, or if I feel that things should be different, this is more or less a failing on my part. I should be working with what's going on. I should be making the most of the situation. But also probably a point of view which just accepts everything as it is,
no.
Is not the best way of it. So
no.
How compatible is it to say that things should be different with the spiritual?
the compatibility has to do with higher consciousness. So if you become familiar with wisdom literature like Bhagavad Gita, then you strive, this is this message of detachment. You strive for light, or wisdom, or truth. You go in that direction. And over here, or all around you, at a certain point in time at least, there's like lots of negativity. It's anything but light, truth. You continue to strive. So that just accepts darkness, and that's just the way it is. There's an accept, but don't resent it. Because that's debilitating. Disempowering, but be light. And be as bright a light as you can be. And that light will dissipate the darkness. It's a fact.
the law of nature. Language is a big darkness. So entire consciousness was lacking, pervasive, this lower consciousness, using these general terms. And, you know, negative behaviors and speech and conduct and values and yada yada yada. That's all around us. And according to Bhagavad Gita and to all of the Vedas, it keeps getting darker. This is the age of darkness, it's the age of this age of horrible strife of yoga. Be light anyways. This is Mother Teresa.
It's a matter of faith.
It's a matter of consciousness as well. If you're conscious, we're tiny, and there's something much greater than us. This universe is greater than us, and the power that's moving this universe is greater than us. But connect with that. And then so that power greater than your power. And you move in the world with that connection. That's yoga. And, you know, and I'm not just, these aren't just words. I live in the same world that you live in. The same darkness around me that's around you. And there's a lifestyle that connects you to that, just keeping it simple, that place of higher consciousness. And when you're connected, you have strength. You don't have to feel oppressed by the negativity that's around you. You're making a difference. Hey, that's a value in the younger generation like anything. Make a difference, right? Activism, make a difference. But the difference that you can do, and that I understood this, it's what helped me become part of something that I didn't want to become part of. That is, I'm a little guy. What can I do? But if I connect with other people of like-mindedness, together we can do so many things that I alone cannot do. But I want to connect with, but it's an individual yoga connection, yoga connecting with that place of higher consciousness. I want to be in that connected space. And if I can have association of others, it will help me. And then I can do more than I can do on my own. Just like coming here, I'm here because there's some other people that are helping, and I'm helping them. Together we can do something more than one would have done. Higher consciousness, goal. And, you know, then you have to choose some other things that are important to you. Like you said, some things are like they don't like. So we're making choices every moment. And select those things that are higher consciousness related. Make your desires, back to, you know, make your desires spiritual. Meaning, in simple language, connected to higher consciousness. The how you spend your time. The courses that you study. With the people you invest time with in your relationships with. It's, you know, people that are going to, it's choices that, your food choices. Your when you go to bed and when you go to get up in the morning. Your regulation. It's going to lead to a higher consciousness. Start making those choices in that direction. You have some strength that you didn't have before. Connect to the place of higher consciousness, you've got a whole lot of strength. You can make a difference. Yeah, sure.
Thanks.
Green ship, there we go.
So, I struggle with the terms high consciousness and low consciousness because we use these terms loosely. Is high the term consciousness related? Like, for example, you gave the scenario of the person coming and screaming at you. Probably for him, he's at a better consciousness because he's doing something for his religion, or something. So how do we know that we are in a higher consciousness?
Well, the standard on there, good question. Read Bhagavad Gita, the answer is there three times. Sky chapter 14, words of nature. Arjun wants to know. It's a good question you're asking. Arjun wants to know. Krishna, you said everyone's influenced by the modes of nature, but there are some persons that are beyond the modes of nature. What are their symptoms? How do they walk? How do they sit? How do they work? And most importantly, how do they get there? So those questions are there, and I can give the answers just now. Or I can point to you where and how many of those discussions are. Maybe because we'll have some Jackson Butter. You tell me where those places are, Bhagavad Gita. Please, sorry, Dr. Shilpa. And, you know, there's ways to measure. External ways. Now, the internal is consciousness, but there's behaviors that indicate consciousness. The behaviors rest on consciousness.
So does consciousness necessarily have to be tied to religion?
This isn't religion. I'm not speaking this isn't, that isn't, the other isn't. It's just a principle of consciousness. We're a spark of life inside. Now somebody can say, well, there you go, that's religion. But, you know, one can easily make an argument. It's not just religion. Want some arguments? It's not just religion. You're okay. If somebody wants to call it religion, they can call it religion. I say it's a science, a spiritual science. Here's something just from the secular world. Ian Stevenson, you heard his name? He's a professor, now deceased, University of Virginia, did studies in people that remembered their previous lives. One of his last books was The Biology and Reincarnation Intersect. So out of the big pie of people who remember their previous lives, he selected a slice. The slice was people who remember their previous life with some mark on their body or a limb that was half born from birth or something that indicated with something from their previous life. I'll give two examples. This is not proof, but it's an indication that there's consciousness beyond the body, called eternal life. So he found somebody who had a lady, girl, that had marks, looked like rope marks around her leg. And she, who was interviewed by Ian Stevenson, who said, in her previous life, she was a man who committed adultery. In her previous life, he was engaging in a relationship with another man's wife. The other man found out, took the man that is messing with his wife, tied him up around the leg with rope, and threw him in the bottom of the well. He died. And in this life, became a woman with rope marks around his legs. The right leg, I think. I don't remember the both. So, Ian Stevenson went to, yeah, were those marks there from birth? Yes, okay. Where did she live in her previous life as a man? He met the husband that murdered the guy that was messing with his wife. They admitted to murder. And how he did it, he tied the guy up in ropes and threw him in the bottom of the well. And the name of the person, they all matched. So, biology and reincarnation is set. It's not proof. Maybe there's some other explanation. But there's a whole book full of those. Somebody who was born halfway. They died being run over by a train. And half of their leg was cut by the train, thrown over the train track, as their body was being mangled. So in their next life, they were born with half a leg. They didn't know who they were, how they died, they didn't put their face. leg is there from birth, went back to the place. Autopsy showed that the person died with half a leg. He knew the name, he knew the event, he knew the time. For biology and reincarnation, you say. So, maybe there's another explanation. But consciousness goes beyond the body, is the understanding. Some people can't remember, some people can remember. It doesn't have to be connected to a trauma.
So, out of all those accounts, people who remember that they did some crime and they died, they got the next birth as a human. So,
doesn't have to be a crime. Doesn't have to be a crime. There's something. There's this American kid, like 6 years old. He died in World War II as an airplane pilot. He knew everything about airplanes, and he's a six-year-old kid. His mother and father weren't Hindu. They weren't Indian. They're American Christian family. They thought, you know, what's our son doing? It's okay, and on and on and on and on. They traced it, traced it, traced it. And they found out who their son was in the street of his life, who their son. Because he knew the name. And he knew the airplane that, you know, how he died. It was the middle of the night and he was trying to land on the aircraft carrier. He missed and he landed in the sea and he died. Beautiful story.
So I was hearing Rosie was talking about his research on past life experiences. And he said that out of his research, after studying all these people who remembered their past life, not a single person turned spiritual, even though
it's okay. It's not to indicate anything other than this one thing. There's a soul that endures beyond the body. That's all. And some people can remember it, some people cannot. That's all. Now, spiritual consciousness is to be aware who we really are. Not just, I'm the very previous life, I was that, and this life, I'm... Neither is who we really are. Bhagavad Gita teaches us to know who we really are. And to live accordingly. Live a lifestyle of one who knows who they really are. And in the relationship that you keep with others, help them also understand who they really are. That's the nicest way to live. Yeah.
You mentioned about having like a spiritual desire. I generally have that, but sometimes I feel like with technology, I kind of lose my focus.
And
it's almost like an addiction, but like I'm like alcohol, I can't just stop buying alcohol. I can't just stop having a computer. So I was wondering, how do you deal with that? Because
use a computer for spiritual purposes. I have a computer. There was a period of time, I'm answering your question, there was a period of time, I wanted nothing to do with computers. I was like, I'm boycotting computers. And so I had correspondence done by people, I would dictate something, they would transcribe a letter, and they would send a letter. So, when I came to understand there are things that I can do in my service to Krishna and the world, that has a spiritual purpose, and I had a computer. Not use it. And careful, because it's really easy to be not careful and get distracted with other stuff. Really easy.
How do you
be principled. You have spiritual desire. And then you get intelligence to guide your mind, to create the senses and take control. If you don't have intelligence, then you're going to get lost. But the good news is, there's a source of intelligence, spiritual intelligence, and that is Krishna. So we can talk about it. But I'll speak to you again on the phone on chapter 15, page 15. He said, the heart will give you intelligence. But if you don't want it, it'll give you something else. But if you have a spiritual desire, you can. What's really important to you? That's the question. What do you really want? Now, right now, there's this. That's what you're saying should be real. Sometimes and sometimes not. Sometimes and sometimes not. There's this. So then purify knowledge. Maybe later on. Maybe it comes more on instead of sometimes on, sometimes wrong. Unsteady to steady. Anishtha to nishtha. What stage of the spiritual evolution? Evolution of consciousness. Unsteady to steady. Abhyasa. Practice. By practice. Do you do yoga?
Yeah.
So, you know the name Patanjali?
Not sure.
Patanjali is like the guy that is like the authority on yoga, very ancient sage. He says, Abhyasa practice has three elements. Real simple. Every day, for a prolonged period of time, with confidence it's going to take you to a good place. If any one of those three is missing, it's not abhyasa, it's not practice. Every day, prolonged period of time, then it becomes second nature, but it gets really energized when you have confidence it's going to take you to a good place. I'm using this term, as a term of consciousness. Okay, I think we're gonna do the...